death, I had forgotten.
Hey, is it true that kid was born from a corpse?
Yeah, Gambino's wife, Shisu, found him.
She was cursed the minute she picked him up. If she hadn't, she'd probably still be here.
Why don't you use a smaller sword, one right for your side?
Guts! It's your first real battle. Work hard.
Bring me that meat.
Bring it to me now!
Sparks. The light born in the clash when two swords meet. They serve me as well. Throughout my life, the moments and people that have defined me, they have all been illuminated by sparks. This is it. All I am. I don't know my dream, but from this day forth, I wield my sword for no other man. I will seek, and sparks will light my path.
Don't touch me. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. Don't touch me.
During the past 50 years, not a single warrior has been able to defend against my attack, except you.
He is far stronger than any swordsman I have ever stood against. He is the strongest. No, more than that, his strength is not human. What can I do? This fight does at least show me that you still value me. Enough to bleed for.
Now it's becoming interesting.
I can sense no anger from him. No rage. No fear. He is empty. Present. Clear.
You know, there's no need for you to worry yourself. It was for my own sake that I did all that. It wasn't for you in particular. It's just my nature.
So that's the only reason? You fought 100 men because it's not in your nature to run away.
Me fighting 100 men means nothing. It has no purpose.
Besides, I owed that bastard some payback. It seems to me that everybody stakes their lives in a lost cause. Looking over them all from up here, I almost think I can see their hopes and dreams flickering in each little light.
What are you men, idiots? Your head has been cut off. Your general is dead. And your castle has fallen. Don't tell me you haven't figured it out yet!
Your death won't be a quick one. You'll be my prisoner, and I'll show you what it is to live hell on Earth.
Either I put everything on the line now, or I die. No, I've been through worse.
I'm so tired. Watch them for me, please.
Hey! Hold it!
I must continue my journey. I will never draw my sword for another man again, or be dangled by another man's dream. From now on, I will fight my own battles. What the hell is that?
The enemy doesn't care about your condition, or whether or not you're a woman. Actually, on second thought, they might be happy about that.
Let's move.
You evaded my attack successfully. Well done.
I see you've got some balls, but you're gonna regret it when I chop your head off with my...
This is war. It's no different from any other war. Nothing's changed. Nothing I can't handle. Nothing! this miserable place. This isn't worth risking my life for. Am I fighting for Casca? No, that can't be it. This isn't the time for thinking. I should only be thinking about wielding my sword and how I'll kill them. Nothing more. It's just my nature.
So that's the only reason? You fought 100 men because it's not in your nature to run away.
Me fighting 100 men means nothing.
Oh my god. Can this be real? There's at least 100 men.
Come on, let's fight! I need it. I have to fight until the voices stop. I want to fight until I remember nothing!
Please stop shaking me. It doesn't seem to be helping the pain.
Guts!
I'd rather fight for my life than live it. When I took my first life, I was still a child without any idea of what I was doing. Yet since that time, I have learned nothing more, only refining the art of slaughter. So that I may live, I take life. My longing would never help me to crush the skulls of my enemies. I became my own master. But then, I learned what I needed to grow stronger.
Struggle, endure, contend. For that alone is the sword of one who defies death.
Reckless and unfocused.
How did you decide to become a blacksmith? Do you like it?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I didn't choose this. This is who I am.
What about you? Are you the only man to never dream?
It's just like any other castle, only bigger. We do it the same way we always have.
I have preserved my sanity. Have I not? Or did I lose it somewhere?
So where do you go from here? Is this not the path that will lead you to your dream? It is what you believe in, right? What's holding you back now that you've come this far? You were always looking skyward. Focused on it. Rising. Climbing. Soaring. Like a hawk flying alone. Reaching for the highest point. Always watching us from above. Never down here. Crawling with the rest of us. Calm. Cold. Supreme. Letting nothing stand in your path to victory. If that's the way that it really is, then what does that make me?
When a person knows the deepest suffering one can bear, so deep that they break free from their original self, their compassion dies.
Tell me why. You could have stabbed me through the heart back there. Why didn't you kill me?
Because I want you to join
your
me, Guts.
Your body belongs to us. You cannot escape.
Your blood, your flesh, your rage.
I submit.
You all right? The men that have died. I Because of my selfishness. Because of me. I am buried under the weight of all those bodies.
Oi!
Hmm?
Don't waste your life.
Myself feel regret or remorse, it could all slip away. And then I would never reach my destined throne.
This man your friend, then know this. When you regard one another as brother, and this man's ambition crumbles, it is your destiny to face your death.
Most worthy offering for the sacrifice.
The end of days draw near for our sacred children.
Thank you.
Is anyone still alive? Judo! Pippin! Carcass!
Hallowed feast in all its glory.
Stoicism is, in fact, a noble philosophy, an excellent philosophy for silver men. For those spirited men who are going to be our guardians. Stoicism is characterized by a rejection of pleasure as the standard of human happiness and human felicity. Stoicism takes the position that the wise man, the good man, the philosopher, is a man who lives in accordance with nature. He fears only abdicating his moral responsibility. He is not afraid of pain. He is not afraid of death. He is not afraid of poverty. He is not afraid of any of the vicissitudes of the human condition. He fears only that he should let himself down and that he should be less than a complete human being. The only matter of concern to a wise and philosophic individual is the things completely under your control. You can't control the movements of the sun and the planets. You can't control whether a leaky ship sinks or makes it to port. You can't control the weather. You can't control other people. You can't control the society around you. There's only one thing and one thing only that you are in control of, and that is you. Your will, your intentions, yourself. In other words, the wise man, the truly philosophical man, is the man who is entirely in control of his own soul, who takes utter and complete moral responsibility for his actions and is indifferent to everything else, not because he doesn't care about other people,
Not because he doesn't care about the felicity of the entire human species, but because it's not under his control. There's no use wondering or worrying about what tomorrow will bring, since tomorrow isn't under your control. Do what's right today, and let tomorrow take care of itself.
I'm not gonna warn you again! Get the hell out of my way! Just hang on!
It's just my nature.
So that's the only reason? You fought 100 men because it's not in your nature to run away.
Me fighting 100 men means nothing. It has no purpose.
The Stoic philosopher is the man who has liberated himself from fear. He's not afraid of death. He's not afraid of pain. He's not afraid of other people's dismissal as a fool. The only thing he cares about is that he should meet his moral obligations. Greatness is the perception that virtue is enough. Virtue, moral virtue, an organized soul which pursues rationally the ends which are good for all human beings. That's the Stoic conception of virtue. Virtue is enough. We do not need wealth. We do not need sexual gratification. We do not need life itself. If moral virtue tells us that we must die in the pursuit of some good end, the protection of our family, the protection of our home, the protection of the innocent, in the doing of right, nothing should be spared, not even our lives. The Stoic wise man is a man who has trained his soul, trained his mind, so that he is not afraid of apparent evils. He is only afraid of real evil. He is afraid of losing control of his soul. The Stoic man is the honorable philosopher, the man who stands at his duty and is steadfast and serious-minded. In living according to nature, what the Stoic philosopher does is examine the nature of the human condition and the nature of the world around us. He discerns his position in nature, he discerns the kind of creature that he is, and he lives in such a way as not to disgrace himself, as not to be less than what he truly could be. He wants to be, if not a god, certainly not less than human. He won't be an animal either. He will live up to the fullest potentials that human being has to offer. A wise man, a man who is disciplined, in control of his emotions, and follows the way of nature, can be a good man no matter what his position in the social structure is. He is not responsible for the social structure, and it is not his problem. Power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Absolute power allowed us to see what the man underneath the body is really like. Imagine a man for whom all the restraints of law and custom and political order are taken away. He can have whatever he wants.
What are you doing here, trembling and afraid?
If a man under those circumstances behaves well, you know something about the soul underneath, because no external constraint is making him do what he is doing. Imagine anything that the bronze, desiring, emotional, irrational parts of your souls want. And now imagine that you can have it.
I feel nothing, as though there were nothing.
Think about a man breaking himself on the rock of an impossible virtue. He has no equals. Everyone he talks to wants something from him. He is the emperor of everything in the world. He owns it all. Everything he says immediately gets done. He has absolute life and death power over everyone. And he's constantly trying to remind himself that, look, although the people you're dealing with are corrupt, evil, and depraved, it's your job not to get angry with them, but to try and teach them and morally improve them.
I have preserved my sanity.
Have I not?
A standing reproach to the idea that we are unable to deal with the circumstances of human life? If you can deal with temptation at that level, I cannot imagine what is outside the human potential. And for the Stoics, we must remember that any virtue which is accessible to any human being is in principle accessible to all of us. We all have a rational nature which allows us to control our feelings, control our behavior, control our connection to other people. What he ought to do regardless of circumstance. He's not afraid of being dead. He's not afraid of being in pain. He's not afraid of having people laugh at him. He's only afraid of doing what's wrong. He's only afraid of making chaos of his soul. Why? Because his soul is the only thing he's completely in control of. It's the only thing he's responsible for. And the rest of it is a matter of indifference to him. He is, in some respects, an enormously lonely man. And in some respects, an enormously sad man. There's a melancholy in this that's terrifically moving. A terrifically lonely man, a man of immense moral heroism, who has no shoulder to cry on, who disdains crying because what's the point of crying? We must live in accordance with nature. Now, here's the natural condition of human beings. They get born, all kinds of stuff happens to them, and they die. Stop complaining. There's nothing to complain about because there's only two kinds of things. There are the kinds of things you can control, and there are the kinds of things you can't. Well, the gods put me here. I didn't ask for this job, but I can't very well give it up. I'd be abdicating my responsibility to other people. Soon you will have forgotten all things, and soon all things will have forgotten you. I will do my best to constantly do what I ought to do.
There's no way that a monster like this can exist. Not in the real world.
You better clean it all up. No dessert for you tonight.
Clean it until you can see your reflection.
Yeah, I want to see my face.
The Stoic wise man has made his life consistent with nature, and nature is universal and everywhere. It exists in every place, in every time. So the Stoic man is never any place but home. A man that has nothing but philosophy to guide him. You are not the meat, but the will, the soul, the internal stuff. To have an orderly soul is the key thing in human life, and that's what makes life worth living. Don't give in to fear. Don't give in to irrational musings. Don't let your imagination run wild. Control your feelings, control your emotions, control that part of you which is you.
What am I doing here? In this miserable place? This isn't worth risking my life for.
The meat, your body, not so important. The other stuff around you in the world, a matter of indifference to you. As long as you follow the way of nature, as long as you act in a rational fashion, then you are a good man and you need worry about nothing else. Don't be afraid of it. It is what it is. There's nothing to be afraid of. Nothing can happen to you in nature that is not a part of nature. And nature contains nothing fearful for the rational soul. The only thing that a man is in control of is the individual ego, himself. If you are in control of that, if you have an orderly soul, then you have a divine soul, a good soul, and your life is worth living. Do your best to control the things that you do have control over. Yourself, your behavior, your intentions, and your actions. The Stoic man says that a virtue that is possible for one man is accessible to all of us. There is no excuse for us not being that good. If we provide such excuses for ourselves, we harm ourselves and we harm others by preventing us from recognizing our true moral obligations. All people suffer, but not all people pity themselves.
Sparks. The light born in the clash when two swords meet. The moments and people that have defined me. They have all been illuminated by sparks. Forget all that has gone before. That which is past is dead. Why burden your soul with dead things? Just to the extent you hold to things that are past, do you still live in the past? Just to the extent you attach yourself to past acts or experience, religions or teaching, do they cloud your soul vision, hiding me from you? They will ever prevent you finding me until you free yourself of their darkening influence and step within, into the light of my impersonal consciousness, which recognizes no limitations and penetrates to the infinite reality of all things. Likewise, the future concerns you not. He who looks to the future for his final perfection is chained to the past and can never get free. You, who are one with me, are perfect now, and always were perfect. You, the perfect, have not to do with that which has been and what is to be. You care not for anything but the eternal now. That only concerns you, which immediately confronts you. What have you, the perfect, the eternal, to do with past or future incarnations? Can the perfect add to its perfection, or the eternal come out of or return to eternity? I am, and you are, one with me, and always have been, and always will be. For it is only the personality that is born and dies, and which seeks and strives to prolong its stay in the body and in earth life. It is only when you can rise up in the realization of your divine immortality, omnipotence, and intelligence, and can cast off all personal beliefs and opinions, that you can free your soul from this perverted relation and can assure your true position as master and king. You have within you all possibilities. Your body, your personality, your character, your environment, your world are what they appear to be to you because you have thought them into their present status. Therefore, you can change them by the same process if they do not please you. You can make them whatever you will by thinking them so. First, know that I, your real self, purposely brought to your attention these things which now are displeasing and which cause you to think them as being what they now seem to be to you. I will open your eyes and cause you to see that the only way you can ever bring about this change in thinking is by first changing your attitude toward all these things you now think are not what they ought to be. For who is the master? Your body, your mind, or you, the I am within? Then why not show you our master by thinking the true things the I am of you within wishes you to think? It is only by your thinking these other things, by allowing these inharmonious thoughts to enter your mind,
and by so doing giving them the power so to affect or disturb you, that they have any such influence over you. When you stop thinking into them this power and turn within to me and allow me to direct your thinking, they will at once disappear from your consciousness and dissolve into the nothingness from which you created them by your thinking. When you are willing to do this, then and then only are you ready to receive truth, and by proper conscious thinking, to create the true and permanent things I within wish you to create. Then, when you can thus distinguish the true from the false, the real from the seeming, your conscious thinking will be as potent to create all things as you desire, as has been your unconsciousness thinking in the past in creating those things you once desired but now find obnoxious. For it was by your unconscious thinking, or thinking unconscious of the control your desires exercised over your creative power, that your world and your life are now what you sometime in the past desired them to be. There is always first the idea, not considering at this moment the necessity or occasion for its appearance. It matters not whence the idea comes. This takes place, however, up to this point, without any volition on your part, other than focusing or concentrating your attention upon the idea. Once I have given your human mind a view of its possibilities and have enlisted your interest, then does your human personality take up its task. For as I created and inspired the idea in your mind, so did I cause that idea to fructify therein and give birth to desire. We have then first the idea in the mind, then the desire to bring the idea into outer manifestation. In accordance with the definiteness with which the picture of the idea is held in the mind, and the extent to which the idea possesses the personality, does its creative power, impelled by desire, proceed with its work. The idea actually comes forth into definite, tangible manifestation. Listen, you have now and always have had, through this power of thinking, dominion over all the kingdoms of the earth, if you but know it. But it is first wholly necessary that you learn how to think, how to know your thoughts, how to trace thoughts back to their source and to banish undesirable ones at will from your consciousness. And finally, how to control and utilize your desires so they will always serve you instead of your being a slave to them. You have within you all possibilities.
Oi!
Hmm?
Don't waste your life.
Nothing is static or permanent. Life is a continuous flow of interconnected moments. Any everyday situation of hesitation or uncertainty, or of inner conflict between opposing emotions, contains characteristics of the intermediate state. A gap or period of suspension when one situation has come to an end and another has not yet developed.
It occurs in the interval between two states of mind, as well as between states of existence, such as birth and death. So do those extremes of emotion when one is on the edge of complete exhaustion or feels one is approaching the borderline of insanity. At such moments of concentrated energy, one may suddenly enter a neutral state in which one feels completely free, calm, and detached. This is an intuitive glimpse of the ground of being, the nature of mind itself, the essence of things as they really are. It is described as indivisible emptiness and luminosity. The six realms of existence represent both the various states of mind into which our consciousness is continually reborn and the different ways of experiencing the world. They arise from the instinctive emotional reactions to the openness and brilliance of the luminosity. The realm of hell, the lowest of the six realms, is the most intense, dominated by aggression, hatred, and anger. Hell can be burning hot, an environment of claustrophobic terror, or icy cold, a frozen isolation that results from pride and resentment towards others. The realm of hungry ghosts develops from greed, a hunger that continually increases and can never be satisfied. Possession brings no pleasure to the hungry ghost, only searching and grasping matter, so there is a sense of endless frustration and disappointment, even though one is surrounded by food and wealth. The animal realm arises from ignorance. It is a deliberate turning away, playing deaf and dumb so as to avoid the brilliant light of reality. It can create a comfortable, predictable way of life, but one that is also very mechanical and without any sense of humor, unable to respond to the unexpected or the unknown. The human realm is based on passion and enjoyment. It contains qualities of exploration, striving, and creativity that may lead to success and fulfillment, but also suspicion and doubt that continually undermine the sense of achievement. The realm of the jealous gods is based on a fundamental sense of jealousy or envy, as though the very existence of others is a threat to one's own survival. Here, no relationship is possible without intrigue. One must always be on one's guard against hidden enemies and on the watch for opportunities to win, either by diplomacy or superior strength. The realm of gods develops from pride, an instinctive self-consciousness which arises when faced with the impersonal openness of the luminosity. It is the highest realm of self-development, pleasure, and peace, with the feeling that one is invincible and immortal. Do not let your thoughts wander. The consciousness suddenly becomes clear. The nature of each moment is determined by what has gone before, just as one's next birth is determined by one's actions during this lifetime. We can say that life and death are actually both taking place at every instant.
I didn't choose this. This is who I am. I spent my youth desperate to forge a better sword, become a more skilled smith. Before I knew it, I was old. I don't even know what the hell I strike the iron for. But there is still one thing I like about it. The sparks. I like seeing sparks. Breathtaking. Life. Bursting before my eyes for just a moment. My life.
Does not give up what he loves. He finds the love in what he does.
Sparks. The light born in the clash when two swords meet. They serve me as well. Throughout my life, the moments and people that have defined me, they have all been illuminated by sparks.
The way of the warrior is resolute acceptance of death. Warriors must learn this way. This is essential. He must practice constantly.
I want to fight until I remember nothing!
The spirit of defeating a man is the same for 10 million men. When you freely beat one man, you beat any man in the world. That spirit can become big or small.
I will seek, and sparks will light my path. What the hell am I doing here? In this miserable place? I'm risking my life. For what exactly?
Driven to pursue it. So driven, they do it entirely for their own sake. It's their dream.
You know, there's no need for you to worry yourself. It was for my own sake that I did all that. It wasn't for you in particular. I'd rather fight with my sword than run away, that's all.
So that's the only reason? You fought 100 men because it's not in your nature to run away.
Yeah, pretty much. Me fighting 100 men means nothing. It has no purpose.
Condemned by fate. You were the one who should have died. On that day 11 years ago, beneath your mother's body. You should have died. You killed her! You know you talk too much.
in battle. This is how you use your mouth.
Soon, a rain of blood, the likes of which you cannot imagine, shall fall down upon you. It will be a storm of death.
Moments and people who have defined me, they have all been alive.
I told you long ago that you belong to me, Guts. I won you that day by my sword. Your life, your death, they are both mine.
Oi, you still alive?
Yeah, think so.
You have the devil's own luck. Come on. On the battlefield, a soldier's life is worth no more than a silver coin.
I lost. It's almost a joke.
We all are swept by this tide known as fate until we eventually leave this world. And the tide of life will recede before we know who we really are. In this world, there must be one man whose preordained course of life is the key to ruling the world. Regardless of his existing social position or class, that man could have the absolute power of a god.
Hey.
Don't move.
No one follows me.
Stakes their lives in a lost cause. Looking over them all from up here, I almost think I can see their hopes and dreams flickering in each little light. So be it.
I can sense no anger from him. No rage, no fear. He is empty, present, clear. They are my soldiers, and they will follow me into the jaws of death for the sake of my dream. Doesn't make them my friends. A friend should never subsist on another's dream. The man who would be my friend must have a reason for living that goes beyond me. And he should put his heart and soul into protecting this dream, even if it means opposing me. For me to call a man my friend, he must be my equal in every respect.
His eyes look as if they're focused on an enemy. But I must go. This fight does at least show me that you still value me. Enough to bleed for.
I had no idea the enemy had anyone this powerful.
My sword has gotten very dull. You'd better pray you die quickly, or this could be painful.
I will have my own kingdom. You must fight for me, because you belong to me. I will choose the place where you will die for me.
The time has come.
The time has come.
Your body belongs to us.
Ah!
I will seek, and sparks will light my path.